Father, we're coming into your presence with thanksgiving. We give you praise and glory, Lord, as we listen to the message that Pastor Roger will bring tonight. Lord, open our hearts and our minds to receive, and we give you all the praise and glory. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Number 249, a new name written down in glory. Number 249 in your hymnal.
Yeah.
number 47, Heavenly Sunshine. Heavenly Sunshine. Heavenly Sunshine.
Thank you.
chorus fits in with the message the Lord had laid upon my heart, and we'll build that bridge so that you can recognize that in a moment. But let us ask the Lord to bless us, first of all, His Word, and may our ground be fertile and prepared to receive it. So let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, I thank you, Father, that we have this opportunity once again to come together in your name, in your house, and in your presence. We ask, Jesus, for your Spirit, that Spirit, dear Lord, that gives us life each and every day, that protects us and cares for us, that puts a wall of fire around about us. Lord, let that Spirit now anoint the Word. Let that Word, dear Lord Jesus, not fall on hard ground, but Lord, may our hearts be soft and prepared to receive, that we too, dear Lord God, can be a source of blessing for others, that the fruit will be evident, and that, Father, it will be bountiful, so that others may see and taste that the Lord is good, and that they will see that in our lives each and every day. Father, to accomplish all of these things, Lord, we need you. We cannot do these things in our own strength. We cannot do these things with our own wisdom or understanding. But Lord Jesus, tonight we ask for you. We ask for you in all things, in all ways, that you would lead and guide and just take us, dear Lord God, into that promised land, the place, dear Lord Jesus, where you are there and we are there with you, that we can have each and every day. So God, I thank you. I thank you, Lord, for time to worship. I thank you, dear Lord Jesus, for opportunities to lift our voices in prayer and in praise. And now, dear Lord God, help our understanding and give us wisdom as we hear, as we look to the Word, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. The world has a way of watering things down. That's not a revelation. That's just a very easy observation. And so the world will sort of look at something and, you know, and a very simple example, one might say, well, I want something to be straight. Could be a board or whatever, it doesn't really matter what. You can think of anything that needs to be straight. And many times it will be measured and people will say, well, it's close enough. And as the world sort of says, and as people, and as even sometimes I suppose we say, it's good enough or it's close enough, really what's happening there is the standard is being worn down. It may be just a little bit, but a little bit turns into a little bit more and a little bit more, and before you know it, the entire standard has been shifted and adjusted. And what we have to recognize this evening, and this is not the main part of the message, but it's an important reminder, we have to acknowledge and recognize that God's standard is the best standard that there can be. And that in many cases, that standard is so high that we cannot achieve that without the Lord's help. However, and this is the important part, I suppose. The important piece here is that God does not lower the standard just because it's hard for us to achieve it. Rather, he says, come unto me and I'll help you. Right? Bring your troubles, bring your cares, bring these things that you might read in Scripture and you find difficult. Bring these before me. And I believe the Lord is there to help us. He's the one who promises to give us strength. He's the one that promises to give us understanding. It's from Him that we can gain wisdom and knowledge. And so, as we look this evening at a message that I have entitled, A Hard Saying, we want to remember that though it is hard, it's not something we have the right to change. And though it be difficult to achieve, it's not something that cannot be achieved if we rely on the Lord to help us. You see, if we look at a quick example of that before we get into my example this evening of what I would consider to be a hard saying, something that we might find difficult. But if you go with me to Matthew chapter 19, as an example, Matthew chapter 19, here Jesus is speaking, and it says, beginning at verse 20, Matthew 19 and verse 20, it says, "A young man saith unto him, All these things have I kept from my youth up, what lack I yet? And Jesus said unto him, If thou wilt be perfect, go and sell that thou hast, and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me. And then when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions." So here's an example, okay, that I just want to plant in your mind and to acknowledge the fact that sometimes the Lord will say things to you or to me or to all of his people which we might find difficult. It's one of the things that happens in the service, right? I mean, if you're alive, which I trust you are tonight, right? And there have certainly been times when I have been in the service and I'm alive, and there's something in that service that pricks my heart. There's something in that message that touches me that perhaps doesn't touch my neighbor in exactly the same way, because God's word is, though it applies to all, it's also very specific. And so it could touch me, it could touch you, and there might be something in a message that we hear that we might say to ourselves, oh, that's going to be difficult. That's a hard one. That's going to be a challenge. And that's what happens here in this example, right? You know, a question is asked by this young man. Jesus gives him a response. Jesus tells him exactly what he needs to do. The young man considers. Doesn't look like he considers it particularly for a long period of time, but ultimately he says, you know, that he can't do it. He doesn't say that, but I mean, he walks away. He walks away, probably because in his heart, I believe, he says, that's too difficult. That's too much. I can't do that. And so I will ask you to notice that Jesus does not chase after him. Jesus does not say, oh, wait. You know, for you, we'll make an exception. For you, we'll change the standard because I don't want to lose you. Well, Jesus doesn't want to lose anyone. But he expects everyone to do and to strive and to move towards the standard that he sets. See, the part in this particular account that this young man failed to realize is further in the chapter. Because when we get to verse 26, "But Jesus beheld them and said unto them, With men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible." With God all things are possible. Write that down, engrave it upon your heart, place it in your mind. Find a place where you will not lose that promise, because that's what that is. Not only is that a promise, but it's a fact. Jesus tells us something that is crucial, absolutely crucial, and strengthens us, should strengthen our faith. With God, all things are possible. See, when that young man heard what Jesus was expecting of him, he obviously, because he walks away, said, that's not possible. I can't give those things up. But what does the scripture say? With God, all things are possible. So there are moments, if you haven't hit them yet, you probably will. There are moments where in our lives, there is an expectation that God makes of you or makes of me, and there might be just a second, a millisecond of doubt or fear, which is there because we think it's not possible. Because God's standards are high. You know, there's a section in Scripture, I won't go into the full account, but it's in John chapter 6 and verse 60. And I spoke on this a little while back. I'm not sure, I can't remember if it was in a Sunday school lesson or what, but where in John 6 and 60, Jesus was speaking, right? He was talking to his disciples, because it says, "Many therefore of his disciples, when they had heard this, said, 'This is an hard saying, who can hear it?'" That's John 6 and 60. So you see, even those that were saying they are followers of Christ, like you and I, disciples, right? When Jesus was teaching, there were times when it was a little difficult to swallow. Not because it was wrong, and that's important. Not because it was something that was wrong, but because it went against the carnal nature. It went against our natural, you know, attitudes and things of, like that. And so therefore, at times, we might say, that's a hard saying. In a way, we kind of start to make excuses when we say that. You know, it's sort of like when somebody says, "Well, but you don't understand my situation." Really, in reality, I would say that person is saying, "What you're saying is a hard saying, and I don't think I can do it." And then they sort of tack on, "Well, you don't understand my situation." Let's remember, God understands every one of your situations and mine. And so when the Lord sets a standard, when God says there's something as God's people you need to do, we should not, we must not look at that and stop when we've said that's a hard saying. What we need to do is we need to say, perhaps we'll say, that's a hard saying, but with God all things are possible. And so even though that's a challenge for me right now, if I come to the Lord and I ask Him for help, and how important is that, right? How important is that? That's really why we should all have really a continuous testimony of thanksgiving. Because, I mean, isn't it true that God has helped you? Right? Hasn't God come to your aid time and time and time again? Now, Satan sometimes will try and persuade us that he hasn't, because, in fact, his support and his help, well, it didn't really look maybe the way we thought it was going to look. And so sometimes we don't recognize that God actually has provided a solution. That's sort of like this young man, right? He was obviously expecting an answer, something different from what Jesus was telling him to do. Otherwise, he wouldn't have asked the question. I mean, if you don't want to hear the answer, don't ask the question. And so he asked the question, Jesus gave him that answer. It was a hard saying. He turned away. He left. Jesus didn't change the standard. And so when we look into the Scripture, and tonight I want to take a look at something that I see in a number of places that we have sort of touched on, I'm sure, before. And yet, it's a hard saying. It's a hard saying. And you've heard this before, but let's just take a look at some examples this evening, where what the Bible teaches us is that before we have the victory, we have to thank Him for it. Now that's, when you stop and you stop, if you're honest, that's a hard saying. And if it's not one for you, then praise the Lord. But I have to confess, for me, that's a hard saying. It's easy to praise God. It's easy to say thank you for the victory after it's taken place. It's easy to testify and say the Lord healed me after the healing has taken place. But it's so much more difficult in our nature, I believe, as people, for us to proclaim thanksgiving for the healing before it's actually taken place. But God instructs his people in a number of places, and we're going to take a look at two of these places. He instructs his servants, he instructs his people to be thankful, to be praising, to put others first before themselves, you see, which I think is a way for us to give thanksgiving to God. See, sometimes the Lord, we're going to take a look actually, and I, you know, jump ahead a little bit. We're going to take a look at Job. And just towards the end, where God is, in a sense, ready to deliver Job from his trials and from his tests, one of the things that we're going to look at is God tells Job to pray for others. And that, to me, is so amazing, because usually when we need prayer, we don't really feel like praying for anybody else. Because after all, we're the one who needs help. But I think in that example and in that lesson is a secret for all of God's people. That if we want deliverance, we praise God for it before we receive it. That's faith, by the way. That's trusting God, by the way. It's a demonstration of it. And the Lord also, I have to say, would know if I was just saying it, you know, for the sake of saying it. You know, you could sit at home this week and you say, oh, well, Pastor Roger said this, and the Bible says this, which is much more important than what Pastor Roger says. And the Bible demonstrates that I better say thank you, Lord, for the victory, even though I don't have it yet. So I'm going to say thanks, God. Well, if it doesn't come from your heart, and if it isn't sincere, obviously the Lord will know that. So I have to ask God to help me with that. This is a big one. Because I want the victories. There are times I need a healing. And what I see in Scripture is that I need to claim it, and I need to thank God for it, and I need to even step beyond that when we look at Job. And I need to forget about my own trial and my own test, even though I don't have the victory yet. And I need to think about somebody else and pray for them first. And when Job did that, by the way, God gave him the victory because of that. And you see, I think we have to take those examples and put them into practice. I mean, what good is the scripture? What good is an instruction manual? We say, here's the blueprint. Here are all the answers. What good are the answers? What good is the instruction manual if we're not going to follow it? I mean, to me, that's ridiculous. Really, to me, that's how the world thinks. You know, well, we know this is right, but we're not going to do it. That's a worldly thinking. That's the devil's teaching. What we as God's people need to ask God for is wisdom and understanding, so that when we look to the scripture, we can say, now here's something I need to apply to my own life. And it might be hard, but don't expect God to change the standard. Rather, expect him to help you achieve that standard if you ask him for help. And that means we have to put aside our pride. We have to humble ourselves before the Lord. And there are times, yes there are, where we have to say, God, I can't do this without you. And in that very instant, when we ask the Lord for strength, I'm confident that he will pour it in. Turn with me, first of all, here to 2 Chronicles. It's an example that we use for a number of different things, but I want you to see again the timing. So part of this is the timing. So as we go through this, I encourage you to think about your own life. Right? If you are going through a trial right now, if you're going through a test right now, I don't care what kind, where it's coming from, any of those things. Let's not make excuses. right? But let us say we want victory over that. Well, how are we going to achieve that? Well, I'm praying. Well, that's great. That's part of it. But this evening, perhaps the hardest part is that you have to proclaim thank you for it even before you have it. Okay? And that's more than just praying for the victory. That's believing that it is done. It is finished. It is finished. So in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, I'm going to jump around here just a little, hit a few verses, right? And here we have this invading army that's coming against God's people. And it looks bad, right? There's just absolutely no way. Like, you know, the neighborhood is all ganging up on God's people here, the nations, and they are going to come and they're going to wipe God's people out. And it looks terrible. So, to their credit, you know, they know what to do. They turn to the Lord, right? And this is Jehoshaphat here, you know, and it says in verse 3, chapter 20, verse 3, Jehoshaphat feared and set himself to seek the Lord and proclaimed a fast throughout all Judah. So, you know, there's all kinds of lessons here. Fasting, prayer, focusing and recognizing that the only chance you've got is from God. God has to be the one that intervenes, right? So then we jump a little bit, and I want to go to verse 12, and it says here, it says, O our God, wilt thou not judge them? For we have no might against this great company which cometh against us, neither know we what to do, but our eyes are upon thee. So there's a statement there of humbleness, right? There's a statement there that says, I don't know the answer. I like people who say that. I do. Right? I would far rather hear from somebody, I don't know the answer. That's so much better than have somebody sort of fumble around and pretend they know the answer when they don't. Right? So there's honesty here. And there's a humble spirit here in the people. Right? And all there says, our eyes are upon thee. We need to look to the Lord. Right? And then God responds, verse 15, right? Just partway through, and he says, Be not afraid or dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Now, it's only God's in this particular case because they gave it to him. Right? They said, We don't know what to do, but we're looking at you. We're looking towards you. And so, if you have a trial and you have a test, we have to give that burden to the Lord. We have to. That's the only way that we can have that deliverance. That's the only way that we can truly be set free, is we have to give it to someone, the Lord, who is stronger and wiser and has the capability to do what we can't do. And then believe when God says, the battle is not yours, but God's. The critical piece that comes in here as they march out towards this enemy, not really sure exactly what's going to happen, right? But we see in verse 21, And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord, that they should praise the beauty of holiness as they went out before the army, and to say, Praise the Lord, for his mercy endureth forever. Verse 22, I've underlined, It is critical. And when they began to sing and to praise, the Lord set ambushments against the children of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, which were come against Judah, and they were smitten. You see, it was when they started thanking God. It was when they started praising the Lord. Victory wasn't there yet. Physically. They were still marching towards the enemy. The enemy was still there. But because of their faith, because they believed that God was the one who was going to fight for them, they were able to praise him for the victory before they saw it. And as a result, and when they began to sing and to praise, that's when the Lord moved. That's when the victory was given to them, for his honor and for his glory. Because as people, we can't do those miracles. Only God can do those things. So we have to let go and let God have His way. And we need to ask God to help us to not, I'll use the term, wallow in our aches and pains and our the negative things that can surround us so very, very quickly. That's why I chose to sing just before, you know, we started the message, I will enter His gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter His courts with praise. That means even when you're feeling bad. That means even if you're sitting there right now and it hurts. That means even if you know this week you're going to face something that's a trial, something that's a test. Regardless of those things, that chorus is a heart saying. Because in truth, if we strive to enter with that thanksgiving and praise, each and every time we enter into His presence, whether you're at home or whether you're coming into church or wherever it happens to be, you see, to do that is to trust God for the victory. And not only to trust Him for it, but to proclaim that you've already got it. To proclaim you've already got it. Okay? So we get our eyes off of ourselves and we focus on what the Lord can do. And that's really what I think we see in Job. Go with me into Job, the very last chapter. It's chapter 42. And let me show you just very quickly this powerful example. Okay? Along the same lines. And I love this because we know Job goes through tremendous trial. Right? We know Job loses everything. His personal health, his family, his wealth, you name it. All gone. Alright? And yet, at this juncture right here, where his friends have come and God is not pleased with them, all right, and God speaks to his friends, Eliphaz and Temanite, etc. He speaks to them and he tells them that they are, if you go to verse 8 in chapter 42, therefore take unto you now 7 bullocks and 7 rams, go to my servant Job, and offer up for yourselves a burnt offering, and my servant Job shall pray for you. And I'm just taken aback by that. Right? God expects Job to pray for others when Job really, by all accounts, is the one who needs prayer. Am I the only one that finds that fascinating? I don't know. Like, to me, that's God really has such a great, that's a hard saying, right? To say to somebody that has lost everything, that is, you know, has had, plague, so to speak, and scabs and all kinds of, you name it, to say to that person, now I want you to pray for somebody else. How do you think most people would react? How would you react? Right. Would we be willing to do that, or would we be so focused on ourselves that we expect, no, Lord, I'm the one who needs prayer. But God says, no, you pray for others, even though your situation is terrible. But notice what happens, right? I'm going to keep reading, right? So where I said, my servant Job, verse 8, shall pray for you, for you, for him will I accept, lest I deal with you after your folly, and that ye have not spoken of me the things which are right, like my servant Job. So speaking about Job's faithfulness, Job never lost faith, never lost trust in the Lord, right? And in verse 8, 9, they come, right? And Job, they sacrifice, as the Lord says, all right? And then verse 10, and the Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. Also, the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. So the final sort of key that unlocks the victory for Job is that he prays for his friends. Okay? And to me, that's sort of the same, really the same idea as what we saw in 2 Chronicles. This idea that Job had enough faith to believe not only that God would take care of him, but that even in the midst of his suffering and pain and sorrow and all of those things, that he still had enough faith to pray for somebody else. And I believe that though that is a hard saying, though that is a tremendously high standard that God sets, I really believe that as the Lord was speaking to me, he said to me, that's the standard that God's people need to demonstrate today. So that means, if I only apply it to myself, which is, I'll do that, that means if I'm going down a tough road, if I'm in a valley, if I'm in pain, number one, I need to accept the fact that I already have the victory because God said so and all things are possible, right? And so I claim that victory and then I step out like Job did and I don't just focus on myself, but now I ask God to touch and heal others. Even though I might not have that actual physical healing myself. And that is faith. That is trusting God. And that's really, I'll say, Christianity in action. That even though you might be going through a hard time, well, let's talk about Thanksgiving, just as a quick example, right? Everybody, I don't care who you are, is feeling some pinch, right? I mean, you know, the dollar doesn't go as far as it used to, prices are all going up, etc., 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 right? Everything's going up except your paycheck. Your bank account's going down, everything else is going up. And then we say, and somebody says, and we announce, we're going to have some boxes for the food bank. And there might be some people, I'm not suggesting it's you, but there might be some people in a congregation when you announce that, that are saying, wait a minute, I need the food bank. Why should I be giving to somebody else? I need it. Can you see the scriptures that I read that tell me and you, we're not supposed to think that way? If Job had thought that way, he would have said to the Lord, I'm not praying for them. They need to pray for me. I'm the one who has a need. God says he'll take care of his children. Do you have the faith to believe that? Do I have the faith to believe that? Do we have the faith to put that into practice? Because when I say I'm a Christian, in truth, what that means is that everything that's in this word, I am striving for, I am believing, I stand for, I want to emulate, I want to show the world, all of these things. So even though it might be tight and my fridge might be a little empty, as Christians, we don't want to focus just on ourselves because my God can do anything. But I need to find the trust and the faith in the Lord to say, okay, I can find a way. Here's a couple cans. Here's something that I can give so somebody else, their need will be met. And why should we then be surprised or should we wonder that if we do that, like Job did here, at the moment he prayed for someone else, God unlocked the door and set him free. God found a way. God gave him double what he had lost. Because my Lord has an endless supply. An endless supply. If only we will believe that my God can do anything. Final verse, just in closing here, to sort of wrap this up a little bit. And it's a very short sentence that the Lord uses in Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9. And I believe this applies to everything, where Jesus says, and this is in this particular case, it says in chapter 9 of Matthew, verse 29. Then touched he their eyes, saying, and it's what Jesus said here that I want you to walk out of here with this evening. He said, according to your faith, be it unto you. There's so much in that sentence. Because Jesus was really saying, I can do anything. There's nothing that's impossible for me. But you show me your faith. And then according to your faith, be it unto you. And there's times, I have to, and let's be real. I'm going to be real. There's times when I'm in pain. There's times when I'm suffering. That's a really difficult verse for me to grab a hold of. Right? Because I would be happy to have lots of faith after the Lord heals me. But Jesus said, according to your faith, be it unto you. So you have to have the faith first. We have to have the trust first. We have to be willing to give unto others first, though we ourselves might think we're in need. But what I see in the scripture is when God's people do that, then God provides the victory. He provides the victory. It's a hard saying, but remember, God can do anything. And if I ask Him for help, and sometimes I guess that's the stumbling block place, we're not always that quick to acknowledge that we need help. When I ask the Lord for help, I'm thankful. I'm thankful, praising Him, that my God says, okay, here I am. Now you do what I'm telling you to do. See, we have to be obedient at that point in time. But my God can do anything. So if you're here tonight and you're struggling and there's a problem, we all have varying problems, degrees of problems, let's claim victory even though we haven't seen it. And if you're sitting there, like sometimes I sit or I'm standing here and you're saying, that's hard. That's hard. I mean, my natural instinct, I'll thank the Lord forever once I see the victory. But God says, no. Thank Him first. You can thank Him again later. But thank Him before, and then God will bring the victory to pass. So stand with me this evening. And let us pray, and let's ask God for help with that. I need to ask God for help with that, so you can pray for me, and I will pray for you, that by God's strength and by His Spirit, He will help us to be people like those people we saw and we read about in Chronicles, or like Job, who never lost faith that the Lord would make a way, and that when God said, well, now you reach out and pray for someone else, he didn't hesitate. He prayed for them. God saw his faithfulness, and victory was his. And it can also be ours tonight. So let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, I thank you and I praise you, Father. I have to say, I thank you for the hard sayings. I thank you for the high standard, though at times I look at them and I wonder, how in the world can I do that? That's impossible. And then I need to remember, as I've shared this evening, that I need to remember that God, you said you can do everything. There's nothing impossible for you. And so, Lord, help me to have more faith. Help me to trust you. Help me to not only have that faith inside of me, but Lord, let it come forth with proclamations of faith statements, of believing, of knowing. This mountain is going to move. No matter what some physician says, no matter what some other people say, no matter what my relatives say, doesn't what the world says doesn't count. Doesn't hold any water. Because what God says, that's where we need to focus. That's where I need to focus. And Lord, as I ask you to help me to grab a hold of that, and as I ask you, Lord, to help us tonight to grab a hold of what seems to be an impossibility. But Lord, if it be your will, we are claiming it and we are believing it has already come to pass. Though I haven't physically seen it with my eyes or maybe felt it in my body, Lord, it's already done. Victory is ours because, dear Lord Jesus, you have won that victory for us. And so I want to let go of my trials and my tests. And I say, dear Lord Jesus, honestly, Lord God, I need your help. That Jesus, you would lead and guide. That you would make the way. That you would provide the answers that I cannot find and I can't come up with. And I'm thankful, Jesus, that your standard is high, that you don't make exceptions, that you don't bend the rules for this person or this family or that family. But Lord, that we can come to you as a family of God and we can say, dear Lord Jesus, I am really short on this one. I'm falling flat on my face. But Lord, with your help and with my brothers and sisters praying for me, not knocking others down or knocking those that are hurting down, but dear Lord Jesus, help us to be prayer warriors, lifting up the fallen, encouraging one another, encouraging, praying, believing that God has already made the way. He's already provided the solution. And Father, I thank you, Lord, that victory is ours today. And that by you we claim it. And Jesus, with the strength that you can give us, Lord God, we want to walk that way. We want to live that way. We want to be overcomers, not in name only, but in reality. Lord, help us to walk above the cares, to rise above the worry, to praise you when there doesn't seem to be any reason to praise you. But God, let there be that joy in our hearts, that as we enter into your gates and enter into your courts, we are thanking you and praising you for what you have done, and for what you are going to do and what is already done. Lord Jesus, if we grab a hold of that, I know that you will not fail us or forsake us. Be with us as we pray this evening. We remember our missionaries. We thank you, dear Lord, for protection. We thank you and we believe for healing. And we know, dear Lord God, that you are able. And dear Lord Father, as the word goes forth, may it fall, dear Lord, on good ground. And help us, dear Lord Jesus, to be laborers that are willing to go into the field where the fruit is ripe and plentiful, that, dear Lord God, others would also come to know you as their Savior. I thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.